Let's talk about GT50. Over the course of the last 2 weeks, two areas of the engine have received most of our attention. The first is the development of the fuel injection nozzles and atomizers. We'll talk about that later. The second is the development of our casting processes for casting super alloy turbine blades to the very highest standards. Now, you've probably heard me talk about before the fact that casting in its own right is a pretty difficult process to do well. If you think of the idea of pouring one cup of water into another cup of water, when the water hits the second cup, it'll create turbulence and bubbles. And if that was to freeze at that instance, as liquid metal does in the casting process, all of those bubbles, all of those defects are trapped within the casting. So what we have to do is develop the means to control the flow of liquid metal into the mold, keep it as smooth and orderly as possible, and then any biofilms, any defects, any entrainment of the mold that happens during the filling process has to be captured by the features that we build into our casting process. So what we've been doing over the course of the last couple of weeks is essentially working through each of those steps to enable us to test the first production-worthy GT50 turbine blades. Now that's broken up into a number of areas. Essentially, what we're trying to do is melt raw superalloy material. So this is an advanced nickel-based superalloy that we need to withstand the searing temperatures within the engine. We melt that down in the new furnace that we showed you last week, and then pour that into a mold. So to do that, we have to develop a running system. This is a simple example of a running system for test bars, where you pour the liquid metal into the top, it runs down a central sprue, out through some runners, and then fills from the bottom up to smoothly and orderly fill the blade cavities. Now, this is just a simple example that I've used to show you the actual turbine blade geometry is a bit more complicated than that. In addition to that, we then have to develop filtration materials to be able to capture any biofilms, any oxides, any damaged shell or block material that's been carried along by the turbulent metal flow and stop that from entering the blade cavity as it fills up. So we've been developing the methods to essentially produce these filters, entrain those within our wax investments, and then get those safely into the mold so they're ready to act as a barrier to impurities getting into the turbine blade casting. And remember, all of this goes on at upwards of 15, 1600 degrees Celsius, so it's extremely hot. In addition to that, we've had to develop all of the flasks and the tooling to adapt our molds and our turbine running systems into the existing casting machine that we're going over to Germany to test. So we've developed a range of methods of doing this, a conventional conical feeder where we essentially create a bowl in the top of at the top of the sprue to feed the metal down into the running system which is captured within there. And then a more traditional shell-based system where we're developing recipes for the shell system that's compatible with the various forms of wax that we're using for the analysis casting process. So all of that work has been completed over the course of the last couple of weeks, and we're essentially now almost ready to go to Germany to test this machine. If the machine works, then we're bringing it back to the UK to start blade casting in-house. The remaining elements that we've got to do, we need to make a slight tweak to the chemistry of the mold powder that we use here. We need to tweak the grade of wax that we're using to be compatible with the existing shell system that we're using. And then we need to do a couple of tweaks to the way we seal our molds onto the casting machine to allow us to pour the metal directly from the bottom of the crucible into the wax mold. All of those trials have been going on over the course of the last couple of weeks using our partner organisation over in Stoke-on-Trent. With these technical details now in the bag, shortly we'll be off to Germany to prove out the machine and bring it home. We finally cracked our fuel nozzles as well, so we've now got a lovely compact dual orifice fuel nozzle design with integral filter, all within the capability of the manufacturing processes that we want to use. So we're now just cascading those changes back through the combustion chamber and then the combustion casing, so that when we put those nozzle features on the test rig and validate their performance, that same nozzle architecture can then go forwards straight into the full combustor test and the gas generator test. Essentially, what we've done is used an extensive amount of computational fluid dynamics to optimize the fuel spray angle, the cone, and also the way that interacts with the swirler that we're using within the fuel nozzle, and also optimized all of the aerodynamics around the combustion chamber so that that whole system works effectively as one. Over the course of the last couple of weeks, the guys have now rapid prototyped a slightly overscale version of the atomizer to allow us to test that in our fuel flow rig. Those tests will be going on Thursday or Friday this week, hopefully. Once we've done that, we can then commit to producing a range of test nozzles that will allow us to complete the last bits of tuning on the original Rufus rig before going to the full combustion test. So really pleased with how that's coming on. The combustion system is quite a complicated physical problem to solve. It's taken a lot of simulation, and it'll take a little bit more tuning on the rig to get it working just right. But we're really, really pleased with how this is coming along. We're currently building the prototype speed reduction gearbox, which will be the ones that we use both for lifing tests and performance testing on the test rigs on the ground. And the final one of those will be the unit that we use to flight test the whole HX50. The last of these gears have just gone out to copper plating. Copper plating is the stage that we do essentially to mask out the areas of the gear that we don't want to carburize and harden. So we copper plate the entire gear blank, and then we cut the roughing passes of the gears into that blank, and it then goes off to be carburized to get the hard surface added to the flanks of the gear teeth to give it the durability, the life, and the performance that we need for use in the helicopter. So the very first of these gears should be due back with us having completed that program in the next 2 weeks or so, just in time for the air conditioning to go into the mezzanine floor and for us to be able to start doing the precision cuts to make the final gear teeth ahead of hardening. We've now completed all manufacturing operations on the 5 prototype starter generator units that we're producing for the first GT50 engine test program. All of these bits have been produced, they've all been test assembled. We've produced the majority of the internal electromechanical components as well. We've got a minor rework to do on some of the wound components to get them to hit tolerances ready for test, but all of that is now completed and ready for testing. The test rig itself is imminently due here at PC1, ready to be commissioned and to start the testing. And then the motor starter generator control electronics, the PMU unit, the prototype boards for those are due here this week also. So very shortly, we'll have absolutely everything we need for the starter generator to start the testing of the real hardware. In addition to the physical hardware, there's obviously a lot of work been going on behind the scenes for the FADEC system. So this is the electronic control system that runs the fuel control and all of the engine's other systems. Those algorithms were developed a long time ago. We developed prototype boards to test the algorithms and to integrate the algorithms with the physical hardware. We're now testing all of that system within a simulated flight environment to look at the response of the engine dynamics and the FADEC hardware and software to prove that's going to give us the governing performance that we need to maintain solid RPM under a wide range of flight conditions. All of this de-risks the use of the FADEC system on the full engine tests, and a lot of the characterization of the fuel control valve is also being done over there on the combustion rig to make sure, again, when this thing goes to test, we've got the lowest risk possible of anything not working the way it should. So much of the design team's attention on the engine is now turned to designing the extensive array of test equipment that we need to be able to test the hardware as soon as it comes out of the machine shop. So we've shown you previously the high-speed test rig that we use to test the starter generator as both a starter and a generator using real loads and real conditions. In addition to that, Craig and Rob have just started designing the speed reduction gearbox test rig, and this is the test rig that will allow us essentially to prove that this whole system can deliver all the torque that it's supposed to do, the lubrication system works properly, and it lasts for the full 5,000 hours that it's intended to under the worst possible operating conditions. So that work is going on currently. In terms of the combustion system, we're going to do a little bit more work on the Rufus 1 rig to qualify the new nozzles and the emissions. That work's going on tomorrow. And then the second Rufus rig that's designed to run the new swirler, the new nozzle, and a full quarter of the combustion system, that rig will be commissioned shortly after we've concluded the work we're doing on the nozzles at the moment. And then we're also producing a nozzle test rig, which is designed to allow us to qualify all of the lubrication nozzles that are located around both the speed reduction gearbox oil system and also the main rotor gearbox oil system. And these are very simple rigs that essentially shoot a jet of oil through a tiny hole and then measure the oil that gets through the hole to make sure that the nozzles are shooting the oil exactly where they need to go. So we can guarantee that we're lubricating the gear teeth and the bearings and the various other components that we need to exactly as we need to. And that's both a development tool, but that'll also be used to qualify the production nozzles for each production GT50 engine and each part of the HX50 transmission system.